We're here with the CEO of Statoil. It is Eldar Saetre. He joins me now. You're right. Oil is trading higher. Let's get an inside perspective. We're almost kissing $60, Eldar. Welcome to Bloomberg. The IMF tell me the synchronized levels of global growth. I hear CEOs give me an upbeat message. How strong is global oil demand?
Oh, well, it's pretty strong, actually. It's growing. You know, I'm talking about 1.5 plus something million barrels per day in growth compared to last year. That's pretty strong, stronger than I might have expected to see, actually, and slightly surprising. But that is basically a very key factor playing into the oil price formation as well.
And is that globally? I mean, the Chinese are importing a lot more. We're seeing some of the stats come through from them. Where's the geography of that uplift in demand?
Well, I think you mentioned that the Chinese demand seems to be very, very robust and a key driver. But basically, I would say still oil price is at the lower end of the cycle. And that, you know, also generally could have an impact on the general demand for our products globally.
So for the lower end of the oil cycle, just listened to Patrick Pouyanné of Total, and he's saying that volatility is out there and the frackers will be hedging like mad. What does it take to get us through $60? What does it take us to break a new bandwidth, as it were, in crude?
Well, I think, you know, we have a solid demand, and it seems to me that it'd be stable for quite some time. So demand picture is obviously going to be important. The shale, how that response to that will be at various levels. I think we might have been a little bit surprised that it's growing, but not to the extent that some might have expected. So I think that will be a critical factor in this equation going forward.
Do you think that shale is perhaps at peak shale? I mean, I see that there are peak production in the last month. Is that my read from what you've just said? Are we hitting peak shale?
I don't think we are heading towards peak shale yet. There's a large potential within shale. What we might not fully understand is what kind of hurdles, bottlenecks are we facing within shale, and how does it work commercially? Because there is a lot of flexibility, optionality within shale, and what does it take to kick off those options?
And living with $50 oil is something you and I have spoken to on a number of occasions. We're coming up to the reporting season. Many people are saying to me, if there's a shift in the scrip dividends across the industry, that would indicate a paradigm shift in optimism. Would you agree with that? Is a shifting of the scrip dividend in the industry a paradigm shift? Is that what we should look for in Q3?
Well, I think that will be a theme for many players in the industry and for many shareholders to see how companies are responding and to what extent that is being abolished and you know, maybe start on other schemes and like buybacks. But you know, I think that's, you know, there will be different responses. But as you say, it will be an important thing to watch in the season ahead of us.
Where to search for new oil? Where to grow? In the Barents Sea, 15 wells were drilled last year. You did 5, made 1 discovery. I just wonder, are we being overly optimistic in terms of what Statoil can deliver from the Barents? Do we need to recalibrate?
Well, exploration is really about being patient, and this is basically opening up a new area in the Barents Sea that hasn't been explored before. So we need to be patient. We have drilled 5 wells. We have accumulated a lot of data, information. We actually made discoveries. In most of these wells, there were hydrocarbons. That tells us a lot for the future. So we will continue next year, approximately 5 wells in the Barents Sea, and then we'll digest all the data information that we have now and see where we're heading going forward.
You just had an election in your home country. Tom, Francine and myself were chatting about this. In essence, you're a walking sovereign wealth fund, 67% of you is owned by the country. How do the people look at Statoil? What more do you need to do to engage with your countrymen and women?
Well, obviously, like in most countries, there is a discussion on the role of oil and gas going forward. Mm. But broadly, I would say there is a you know, consensus, a broad political consensus in support of our industry and a recognition that we will play an important role in the energy mix for decades to come. Yeah.
And Patrick Pouyanné, just reflecting back on the opening speech in there, he talked about 6 billion customers and there will be 9 billion customers in a number of years. You're not reinventing Statoil, but you're changing the form of Statoil. How much of your business will be renewables in 5 years' time?
So we define ourselves as a broad energy company coming from the legacy of oil and gas. We have invested in renewables for quite some time. We will see that we will grow more within renewables, the renewable space, than within oil and gas. But to be precise on how much, it's difficult. We say 15 to 20% of our capex will be within renewable or new energy solutions by 2030.
Spencer Dale, the chief economist over at BP this morning, said that electric cars will not have a huge impact on oil demand. Is this an Amazon moment, Whole Foods Amazon moment? Is that a complete misinterpretation of what could be the biggest shift of all in the world?
So I think electric cars is definitely here to come, here to stay, and will play a really important role. In the scenarios that we are drawing for the longer-term future, we actually say it could be mostly electric cars, on light-duty fleet, that is, and plug-in hybrids by 2050. Still, we would need a lot of oil and gas because there's more transportation. There's the heavy trucks, there is the ships, there is the planes, and then you only covered 50% of the global oil demand, right? The rest is within industries and so on. So it's a huge, the complex demand picture that the most people doesn't fully recognize or realize. So in that respect, you know, it doesn't change fundamentally, the electric light-duty vehicles, but it will have definitely an impact on demand going forward.
Aldo, thank you very much. Pleasure to have you with us on Bloomberg.